Hello guys, this is Alessandro from the Italian Institute of Technology. Today I want to talk to you about material science. So I prepared a presentation that is an overview of all the tools and the information that the material scientist should have in order to design correctly microelectromechanical systems and nanoelectromechanical systems, so MEMS and NEMS. In particular, those systems are very important for the development of integrated devices. The idea is that if we use different materials, not only the standard semiconductors, metals, and dielectrics, and we process them in such a way to integrate all together very complex structures, which could be even active, even in motion, we were able to realize something which is normally microscopic. Reducing it to the microscale, there are two interesting phenomena that occur. First one, we have access to something which is not really feasible in the macroscopic scale. For example, you can even extract energy from the Brownian motion of molecules. In thermodynamically speaking, it's difficult to do it at a microscopic scale. As a second positive thing, we are able to scale down and reduce power consumption, volume, mass, which is something very important towards space. Let's go to the definition of microelectromechanical systems. This is actually something that springs out from microelectronics. Microelectronics gave us the tools to process silicon at the microscale using optical lithography and wet etching, dry etching, deposition. All those processes allow to structure and create a geometry, very complex geometry, of a two-dimensional surface. Of course, if we repeat the process, we may have access even to the third dimension, which is perpendicular to the thin plane. And we eventually gain the opportunity to realize massive bulk and volume structures scaled down at the microscale. So, actually, it's very important to understand what's the material category, what kind of function I can realize with the different materials, and how I can integrate them in a single device in order to design new applications. So material science is something that connects together the structure of the materials to the properties they have, while the materials engineering connects together the processing, standard processing of the materials with the properties they have. So it's important to have knowledge of both fields in order to start from the material, deposit it or process it, structure it by means of industrial tools available, and finally end up with a device that has the properties that correctly address all the requirements we have. This is a sort of a systematic study. So we can do this without the need for trial and error approach. So we know everything about the standard materials, we know everything about the crystalline structures, about the physical phenomena that are involved. They have been studied for a very long time, a couple of centuries. So we have a huge amount of knowledge that we can access and use to design the devices. There is also something which is not known, and this comes from the nano side. Of course, there is very much work to do in that direction. So every year, researchers all over the world develop new materials that give you new functionalities. So you should stay tuned and really follow what's happening in the world in order to, you know, don't lose anything about the potentiality. So let's go back to the pyramid. This is a pyramid of structural properties, synthesis, and performance. The lower part of the pyramid is the science part, and the upper part of the pyramid is the engineering part. Both are very important to achieve the best results. This is an example of a standard industrial process that is used to prepare a MEMS. So you start from the growth of a crystalline material. Usually it is a monocrystal, meaning that all the atoms in the macroscopic structure are perfectly ordered according to a specific crystalline lattice. Then there is the so-called wafering process, which is cutting into small slices this single crystal and keeping information regarding the direction of the plane, because it is possible to cut the material on different directions and obtain planes which have a different stacking of atoms, so different distances between the atoms and different coordination, meaning that you can have, for example, a square coordination, a hexagonal coordination. So those different coordinations and distances between atoms give you different properties. The surface of a crystal is very important to, for example, achieve electrical properties, wetting properties. Since it's an interface, it's crucial depending on the other phase to which it faces, for example, gas or liquid or another solid. Afterwards, there is a film formation process. Film formation means that we are growing something else on this mechanical substrate. This requires other technologies such as the physical vapor deposition systems or the chemical vapor deposition systems or other deposition systems that allow you to transfer one substance above the substrate. Then you have the lithography, which is the structuration, so the transfer of geometry to the two-dimensional substrate and the film that integrates. This is done through several sub-processes, like, for example, the resist deposition, the resist exposure, the resist removal, the etching of the substance, and the strip-off of the resist. Finally, there is the dicing. So when you have this wafer with all the devices realized on top of it, you divide the devices into dice, so-called dice, like, for example, the single CPUs, and then you pack the devices. So you place those small pieces of semiconductor on a case, you bond the chip, realizing electrical connections through, for example, wire bonding or ball bonding, and then you close this case in order to protect your MEMS or chip structure. What kind of materials can we use? We may achieve, for example, structural devices or microfluidic devices through a certain kind of polymers. We may achieve electronical properties through semiconductors and metals and dielectrics. We may achieve optical properties through, for example, glasses or ceramics or fibers. We may achieve sensing properties through piezoelectric, piezoresistive materials. We may achieve energy storage, for example, through lithium ion systems, which are nanocomposites or layered structures. We may achieve many different properties through the use of different materials. So here I wanted to show you which are the most standard and most popular processes for the growth of single crystals. This is known as a Czukraski process. Czukraski was a Polish scientist, engineer. He invented this process that starts from a seed. So actually you should have a single crystalline, very tiny portion of the same material that you want to grow. Then you place this seed, which is connected to a rod, into a melting pot, okay? And the raw material that you want to grow should be fused, so in liquid state. So afterwards, you will pull up from the wire or from the rod the seed and slowly start to spin the liquid, the molten liquid. And the atoms will slowly add to your seeding system and realize a perfect structuration, a monocrystalline structuration of the atoms. Of course, there are many issues in this process. For example, you should carefully control the spinning of the molten part. You should carefully control the extraction speed of the rod, the temperature profile, and the uniformity of the chemicals. For example, if you want to grow already doped crystals, it is really easy to have inhomogeneities of the doping level through the growing cylinder. These are all issues that have been solved by engineers at such a level that it is very easy to grow with commercial means silicon cylinders that are huge in diameter. This is to reduce the production cost and have the opportunity to place in one single chip, one single wafer, really thousands of chips or of MEMS. Another very important tool is impurity doping. So what gives you the real functionality regarding the semiconductor? So let's suppose that you want to realize, for example, a solar cell. Solar cell is basically a junction between two different semiconductors, one P-type and one N-type. At the interface of those two, you have the so-called depletion region and the place where when the photons arrive and carrying their electromagnetic energy, they separate and generate the so-called excitonic couple, which is an electron plus a hole, and those two are attracted by the respective P and N type, and they are injected into the electrical circuit that is closed towards the load resistance. So that is how the energy is converted. In order to realize the PN junction, you should start, for example, with the intrinsic, non-doped silicon wafer, and then inject certain kind of atoms that allow you to have the N-type semiconductor or the P-type semiconductor. You do this by using ion implantation, which is basically an accelerator of ions that is able to provide a certain kilovolts of accelerating energy to each of those ions, and that changes locally the property, electronic property of the silicon in this case. What kind of MEMS can we realize using the same microelectronic technologies that we have already seen? We are able to realize very complex structures. In particular, here you have some examples showing you that it's possible, for example, to have mechanical ratchets, so systems like in the clocks that are able to give you a movement in one single direction. You are able to realize micromirrors. Micromirrors could be very useful for space application in order to steer laser beams or to realize telescopes or lenses. So it's possible to have a structure that is detached actually from the substrate and separated from it, and it is suspended, like in this case, through electro-thermal actuators that change shape and give you also the positioning of the mirror depending on the distribution of the heat inside those actuators. Well, the idea is that you just drive a current through those beams, those very tiny beams, and when the current flows, it releases heat because of the Joule effect, and that heat is able to deform the silicon beam and then position the mirror, so reflecting the light in the direction that you want. This process is quite fast also, so you can think of realizing an LCD projector which has mirrors to drive the light. Another application is that of microfluidic. This is very popular too. What you see there is a very simple and basic mixer, so you can imagine of having fluid flowing through those channels, and the separation of the channels, the branching of the channels, allow you a perfect mixing of the fluids, which is a very crucial fact, in particular at a microscale, because at that scale, the surface phenomena, with respect to the volume phenomena, have a huge weight, huge importance. So all the friction and all what we know from our macroscopic world is something that in the microscopic or nanoscopic better world is not really happening. Another application that I have shown is that of nano or micro fuel injection systems. So you may even think of realizing micro rockets with an integrated liquid reservoir and integrated liquid injector. And also an accelerating grid, as it's done here. Of course, those components are much more sensible to wear and to eventual damage, because if you think of having a hot plasma or something like a jet engine at the microscale, then you should be very careful to the wear of those materials. And probably the robustness of this technology is not really sufficient to guarantee working in space for a long time. Regarding the substrate, we have many different options. So normally what is used widely, both for the microelectronics and for the MEMS, it's silicon. Silicon is the principal component of silicon dioxide and silicate, so it's very abundant on the Earth crust. You may see those cylinders that have been grown through the Czochralski technique. They look like metal. So when the semiconductor is slightly doped, he is able actually to sustain an electron current, and those electrons interact with the visible light. And we have the feeling that it looks like a metal because it is able to conduct the electrons. But another application of the same Czochralski method and different means of producing MEMS is that of growing other materials. For example, gallium arsenide. Gallium arsenide is a binary semiconductor. It is very important because it has a direct band gap. What does this mean? The point is that if you want to realize optoelectronic or photonic devices and you want the light to interact with the band structure of the material and to better convert efficiently the energy, electrical energy, into an optical phenomena. So for example, what is needed for transducing light into an electrical signal, you need to have a direct band gap semiconductor. Otherwise, when the light is coming, the energy that the light carries is not perfectly matched by the energy of an eventual excitonic couple that is generated. And you need some more lattice vibration, for example, to compensate this mismatch. In direct band gap semiconductor, this is not likely to occur. So you have a perfect matching between the two phenomenologies. That's why gallium arsenide is used in all photoelectronic devices, like, for example, the photodetectors, phototransistors, and it's very important semiconductor. Of course, it's much more complicated to grow a perfect monocrystal of gallium arsenide, because in that case you have to think that both the gallium and the arsenic atoms are perfectly positioned in a lattice, in a complex lattice. So it's much more complicated. Another example is the application for the gems, so for the precious minerals that are used as gemstones. For example, it is possible to grow synthetic ruby or synthetic emerald or synthetic corundum crystals. For example, synthetic corundum corresponds chemically to aluminum oxide, which is also known as sapphire. There are many applications for this. For example, the glasses of the clocks or other substrates which are very, very high performance, because the aluminum oxide is able to withstand up to 2000 degrees, so it's perfect for space application, for certain kind of circuits that should work at huge temperatures.